United States. There's 44,193 Americans who die by suicide every single year, and every 4 seconds, a teenager attempts suicide. What does that mean for a culture? When I look at that and I see those stats, and I realize that there's a problem, that people are living hopeless lives. And when a culture of hopelessness latches on to something like the book, which this originally started as, The 10 Reasons, or if you're like me, you wait for it to come out, to the movie or a TV series that we never read. You see like this phenomenon hit, and 13 Reasons Why, it took off, and it's the largest streamed series ever, but it's also the most tweeted about series ever from Netflix. And I believe it's changing the way that people look at the world. So if you've seen this series, if you've heard about it, you realize that here's the crux of the scenario. There's a young lady named Hannah, and she's the lead character. Maybe you're like her. Hannah is in the shoes of someone that is, well, in the moment, about to take her life. Some of you guys may have felt that way in one point in your life where you feel like you just didn't have any hope. Or maybe you're Clay, and this is where a lot of my, I guess, bringing up my adolescence centered around is that I knew a lot of people like Hannah. She was suffering from bullying and depression, and maybe that's you. Maybe you are dealing with these kind of things, school stress, maybe it's abuse, maybe it's a broken family. Just because everybody looks put together on the outside doesn't always necessarily mean that everything is right on the inside. And you look at these students and you look at your friends and you realize, how in the world am I gonna ever help them? What kind of truth is gonna set them free? So today I just kinda wanna share a little bit about that truth. I want you to know that life really is worth living. There is hope, and there is hope from turning darkness into light and from feeling like you are depressed, and you take that fear and that weight and turn that into courage and hope. So I hope to redefine the narrative of 13 Reasons, because I think the series misses it, because they go every single episode and there is this moment where you feel hopeless and that there is nothing that's pointing to hope. And I want to give you that hope today. And I believe that there's several questions that we just need an answer that's going to springboard life into full hope. So I want to tackle three things with you. I want to tackle the hard question of existence: why am I alive? And then the questions of importance: do I really count for something? Does my life matter at all? And then the last question is the importance of intention. The question of intention: what is my purpose here? What am I doing? And so that's where we're going to begin. So the question is, why am I alive? And does my life count? What's my purpose? Those are those things that, there's something more important than asking those three things. Now, they're not really new questions. In fact, they've been around forever. If you look in the book of Jeremiah, you see that this prophet that lived thousands and thousands of years ago asked the exact same thing. Jeremiah 20:18, he says, why was I born? Was it only to have trouble and sorrow, to end my life in disgrace? And Jeremiah was probably having a really bad hair day, okay? And so, you know, like he was thinking that everything was a mess, and Lord, all you're giving me are these trials, all you're giving me this stuff to deal with. And so he just was struggling with it. And everyone's asked that question, at what point am I, what am I here for? Am I really here just to have these problems? And this question can be really, really frustrating, especially when you are kind of just sitting there thinking like, okay, so life is really this big joke. I just don't get it. A lot of us don't get it. And you go to a Christian school, and so you might pretend you get it at some level at some point, but deep down, some of you are wrestling. Some of you are wrestling and you think that there's not really a purpose for you, and I'm telling you that there is. And so if you're wrestling with that, what is my purpose in life? Let me give you three options. The way to figure this out is there's three different ways that society tries to deal with it. The first one is the esoteric option, meaning that it's this mystical, misunderstood kind of thing. You're gonna find answers that culture is gonna tell you in New Age books or in little trendy blogs. It basically goes like this, that you need to look within, you gotta look deep within yourself. The more that you look inside yourself, then you're gonna figure out your purpose in life. It just sounds really spiritual. So Well, they're really, really good, right? But the only problem with it is, it don't work. It doesn't work. You know, if you could look within yourself and discover the reason why you were here, you probably would have figured it out already. You know? So, they try to tell you that if you look inside yourself, you'll figure it out. But my heart is to tell you today that only the Creator can tell the creation who or what he and she should be. So we have to look to our Creator to find our purpose. How many people have heard of Oprah? Yeah, I read, she's got a little magazine called Vogue. And so I was walking through Books a Million, and I saw it, and I was like, and it had on like a big like cover, like leak right here. This article teaser said, look inside to discover your purpose. So I looked inside, and I was like, dang, I'm going to discover my purpose. Oprah's going to tell me what it is. And she didn't need her magazine, so one, I felt really, really dumb. But then I was really disappointed, because I get to the end of the article, and it says, remember, you've got to figure out your purpose by yourself. Thanks, Oprah. That was really deep. It's like, I love you. It's like, I'm stupid. But then I'm waiting for her Christmas ambition because she got some of my favorite things. All right. Now, the fact is, the more that you look within yourself, that esoteric example, that approach, it just doesn't work because you just can't find stuff by making it up yourself. So then you got the second approach that a lot of people lean towards, and it's that self-help option. You know, the Amazon is awesome. You can look for a bazillion books on Amazon, and they will tell you all the same things. So let me save you some time from spending your $9.99 on your Kindle, all right? They will tell you that you've got to invent your own words, that you've got to be your own self. You've got to create it, discover it, or go out and make it up. And take the same predictable steps. Consider your dreams. Believe you will achieve, right? Those kind of moments where you're like, oh, man. Like, never give up. You got that little cat poster that's hanging like, hang in there. Right? No. So all those things, you can do whatever you want. It'll say that, man, if you will follow these rules and you do these things in life, you will become crazy successful. But you might be the most successful person on the planet Earth, and you still don't know why you exist and what your purpose is for living. You still might be empty enough to, like, all the stuff that you have, all the things that you've accumulated, doesn't mean anything. Because if life has no purpose, is it worth it? And I'm telling you that your purpose is far greater than any kind of personal fulfillment that you have, than anything that you can achieve, than anything than your own happiness, any kind of peace of mind. Those are all great things. But that's still not why the world you were put here on this earth. You were put here for something so much greater than that. So self-help doesn't really help because you were made by God, and you were made for His purposes, not what you make up about yourself, not what you're going to have to go out there trying to discover, not what you're going to have to go try to work for. You'll find that that will be empty. And until you understand that your purposes are God's purposes for your life, you're going to come up feeling empty. So the esoteric, that look within, doesn't work really well, and the self-help or make up your own example of why you have a purpose doesn't really work. So then a lot of people go to the philosophical and they're going to be like, oh, okay, here's my option. You know, I'm really, really smart, and I'm going to study all these philosophers. Okay, so Dr. Hugh Moorehead is a philosopher at Northeastern Illinois University. He wrote 250 of the most profound, like, scientists, writers, philosophers of the 20th century, and he asked one question. He says this: what is the purpose of life? And then he took all their writings and he put it in a book, and now you can buy that on Amazon too. And here's what it says: we don't know. They wrote back and they said, I just don't know what my purpose is. I don't even know if there is a purpose in life. In fact, one of the philosophers that wrote it back said, if you figure out what the purpose of life is, please tell me. So life without a point is pointless. Life without a purpose is pointless. And a life removed from having a relationship with God feels empty. Because it is. We remove God from our culture and the suicide rate is skyrocketing. There's the second leading cause of death between 15-year-olds and 25-year-olds is suicide. And it's not because they watch 13 Reasons Why. It's because they're living life and they feel like they were designed for a purpose, but they can't figure out what it is. And so when I was your age, I toured in this national musical for all high school. It was called Dead Serious About Life, and it was about teen suicide. It was a Christian musical, except it was the kind of Christian musical that was a little in your face, because you didn't really know it was a Christian musical until the second act. And it was something that you did want to sit next to your mom and dad, because it would be super awkward with the content, because, yeah. So I went and saw this, and then I got in the group and toured for 3 years. And But I played the lead character one year. His name is Andrew. And it opens up and you're at a party and he's freaking out on his best friend and saying, listen, you know, my grades suck and I'm about to fall out of school and I'm about to lose my basketball scholarship. And then he tells his friend that his parents are getting a divorce. And then halfway through the party, he finds out his girlfriend's pregnant. So he goes up to his bedroom and he writes his letter to his mom and to his girlfriend and sings his suicide note. And at the end of every first act for 2 years, they would shut the curtains and shoot off the blanket and him would kill himself while on stage. And then so the second half left all these kids trying to figure out what in the world to do. They would open up at Andrew's funeral. And then the next scene was sitting down with the youth pastor of the kid that was at the party, trying to figure out and what to make heads or tails of all this and what the purpose of all this was. And at the end of it, we would sing the song called There's a Better Way. We would sit across the stage, and someone would share after their play was over, they would share their personal testimony. And then you would watch hundreds and hundreds of students flood out of their chairs and come down to the front. This was never held in a church, it was always at a public school. And they would just come down like a dozen of them. And then we would go and jump off the stage and meet them halfway and take them back to a counselor and pray with them to accept Christ and to talk through some of the issues. And I remember at the end of that, I would see a lot of kids that would have rubber burns on their neck or gashes in their arms or just that pain in their eyes. And so I dealt with this for year in and year out. So this hits really close to home to me. And so needless to say, Netflix series, it's a real thing. But I was bullied for 7 years of my life. Before I joined this music group, I saw it for the first time. And it hit home with me, and that kind of changed my life forever because I used to sleep with a knife under my pillow, just praying and hoping that I would be strong enough and just to end it because I was so tired of it. And I went to a great church. I had Christian friends around me, even in a public school setting. But if it had not been for my friend that invited me to this musical, I don't know what I would have done. Because I found life, and I found life of living. And I found a hope that changes everything. Because I asked over and over again, why did God make me? Why am I alive? Why am I going through this? And is there a purpose for any of this? Is there a purpose, God, for what you're letting me live through? Is there a purpose? And I found that there was a purpose for me. I'm telling you today, there's a purpose for you. Proverbs 16:4 says, the Lord has made everything for his own purpose. Not for my purpose, not for your purpose, for his purpose. God made us, and you are made for his purposes. God never makes anything without a reason why it's ever. So, okay, Scott, when he's created for his purpose, great. But why? Ephesians 1:4, here's the message verse. It says, long before he laid down the earth's foundation, he had us in mind, and he settled on us as the focus of his love, to be made whole and holy by his love. You are the focus of God's love. God said that I was created to be loved by God, period. John 4:8 says that God is love. And guess what? That he's created you to be that object of his love. And he made you to love you. He didn't need you. He didn't need me. He just wanted us. He wasn't lonely. God has a relationship within himself, but he created you with the intention of simply loving you. That is why you are alive. Notice that it says long before he laid down the earth's foundation, he had you in mind. God thought each and every one of you before he created this entire universe. That makes you pretty important. Before he figured out where he was going to align in plans, he thought of you. He planned you before the foundations of the earth. And until you understand that God's motivation is simply just to love you, you never understand why you're here. But he created you to love you. The second question left that we deal with this, the questions that are important. It's like, so does my life really count? What am I doing right now? Does it really matter? God made me to love me, but does my life count for something? I'm telling you, this is another question that's been around forever. Isaiah 49:4 says, my work all seems useless. I've spent my strength on nothing and for no purpose at all. No purpose. None. So, you know, without purpose, life seems trivial, seems kind of pointless. But I'm telling you, you and I, we were created to count. You were created to matter. And you have to feel that way in order to have hope. And then you have hope then to deal with life and the things that sometimes come up and the things that are hard to deal with, the things that you never thought you were ever going to deal with. That sense that you matter to God and that you have a purpose for living gives you hope, and that hope continues to keep you moving forward and keep living. You know, you can jerk out your ride all you want to. You can be the big dog here on campus. You can have all the money from your after-school job. But it doesn't, not going to satisfy you. You have to have something deeper in your life. You've got to count. You have to have this need for importance to be fulfilled. And so how do you find it? You find it now that you matter to God. And when you understand that, and when you get that, and you realize that that sense of importance that you're longing for is fulfilled within Him, then everything begins to make sense. How do you matter to God? Isaiah 44:2 says, I am your creator. You were in my care even before you were born. That's how much you matter to God. Well, your mama was still carrying you in her womb. God cared about you because God planned you. You're not an accident. You're not a moose. You know, there are accidental parents, but there are no accidental kids. There are illegitimate parents, but there are no illegitimate kids. There's no illegitimate child. There are unplanned pregnancies, but there are no unpurposed people. See, God even uses people's mistakes and human errors in those moments where they think that they're making a mistake. God even takes something like that and makes it beautiful. He said, I know the exact DNA combination that would create you. And I wanted you here. And I planned you before. I planned this entire world. That's how much you matter. That's how much you count. That's how much you matter to me. Psalm 139:16. You, God, scheduled each day of my life. Before I began to breathe, every day was recorded in your books. That's what David said. Every single solitary day was planned out by God. That's how much you matter to God. So God is very interested in every detail of your life. He's seen it all, the good, the bad, the ugly. He's recorded his book even before you were born. So that means for me, when I was age 16, God recorded that I was going to sneak out of my parents' house at 2 a.m. because I thought I was cool and I was going to get to my friend's house. Yeah, my curfew was 11. And so then I thought, well, I'll be really cool and sneak out and drive away with my lights off so my mom and dad won't see me pull away. And then I drove into my neighbor's mailbox and shattered glass. So God knew that was going to happen. Because I'm a moron, and it's awesome. But God knew that the dumb mistakes that I was going to make, like, He's recorded all those things. But He's also recorded all the great things. But God's also recorded all the things that would hurt me and all the things that I would live through. God's recorded all the things that I would do to hurt other people. And the same with you. God still loves you, though. And He still has a plan. He still has a reason for you. So never doubt that you matter to God, because you do. Lastly, the third question, and I'm closing with this. This is a question of attention. What is my purpose? I've said purpose about 1,000 times, because I want you to get it, that you have a reason for being here. And it's way more than 13 reasons. Maybe God made you love me. Maybe I'm here because, you know, He decided that I matter. But what's my purpose? David had the same question in Psalm 89:47. Why did you create us? For nothing? See, who's David talking to? He's not talking to himself. He's not talking to somebody else. He's talking to God. And he's saying, what in the world am I here for? So follow me. If you don't know what something's purpose is, how do you go and find that out? You talk to its creator or the inventor, or you go look at the owner's manual. Or in our case, we go to YouTube and figure out how it works. Right? But you have to figure that out. So if I don't know why I'm here, who do I go to? I go to my creator, and then I go to the owner's manual. I go to His word. I go to the Bible. It tells us everything that we need to understand about the written revelation of who God is and what He wants out of my life. So you're not going to find your purpose in anywhere else in life other than your creator and the owner's manual. Proverbs 9:10 says, knowing God results in every other kind of understanding. So the more you know about God means this, you're going to understand the more that you will grasp about your meaning and your purpose of why you're here. The first verse of the Bible says, in the beginning God, not in the beginning you, not in the beginning me. He determines our life, not you, not me. God was in the beginning. In the beginning He created. It all starts with God. It doesn't start with me. It doesn't start with you. It starts with why God put us here on this earth. Colossians 1:16 says, for everything, absolutely everything, above and below, visible and invisible, everything got started in him and finds its purpose in him. It's in Christ. Ephesians 1:11 says this. It's in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. Part of the overall purpose he's working out in everyone and everything. That's what Paul tells us, that God is working out everything for us. And God is calling those that are called according to his purposes and what his plans are for our life. And he's working out all the things for your good. The good, the bad, the ugly, everything. God is fighting for you and not against you. God is on your side today. And if you want to know what your purpose is, you've got to know God. You have to have a personal relationship with Jesus. Before I saw that play, I didn't have one. I went to church. I did church. I was really good at pretending. But then I encountered Christ, and I met someone that radically flipped my life upside down. And I spent every day with him since, reading his word, praying to him, just talking to him, not making up stupid speeches, not trying to sound smart, just talking to God, being real, being legit, and just having a conversation with him. Every day of my life. And he's changed my entire life. Paul says this in Acts 10:35, when he quotes, he says, it makes no difference who you are or where you're from. If you love God and you are ready to do as he says, the door is open. The door is open. He's waiting. He's the reason to live. I'm telling you, if you're struggling today, find life that matters. And you can find that in Christ Jesus if you just take the time to develop a relationship with him, to know Christ, and a vision that you'll live your life out, making him know. The two reasons why you matter the most: to know Jesus, to love God with your whole heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love others. Let's pray. Lord, we just love you. We thank you so much for this day.